So my name's Steve Vear, I'm 33. I've recently been promoted at work, having just run a project to integrate two companies together. I work for a company called Tech Data, where I'm now the head of customer services. And ever since I was born, I've been living with cerebral palsy, which was caused through lack of oxygen at birth. I want to enjoy life as much as I can, and arguably there are two ways in which I think you can look at life when you have difficulties that perhaps I've had in the past, or you know, disability that I'll never not have, is either to live life to the full and push myself and push boundaries and push people's expectations, or to get down and perhaps complain and perhaps give people a negative persona, which I really don't want to do. I think it would be easy for people to think, disabled person, it's good that they've got a job, working in a supermarket, or they've got an admin job, that's great. And for some people, that would be sort of the height of their expectations for people with disability, rightly or wrongly. And, some people don't feel that way, but some people definitely do. And so why shouldn't I push that expectation and just see how far I can go? And I think that I've come a long way from that doctor saying to my parents that it will be a special school and it will be a very challenging time and not sure what sort of life holds for him. So I'm always looking for that next challenge and to do things as best I can. I think it has small challenges day to day, and I think those challenges have probably reduced over time. I think, in my childhood it was probably more difficult than it is now. I'm very independent, I drive myself, to places, I've got my own car. I do drive out a car with hand control, so I'm not able to use my feet because I lack strength, and so I don't have the ability to do it without help effectively. But I'm very independent, so at work and in my working life, I have to be aware of where I'm going, if I'm visiting customers or visiting our warehouse, and making sure that access is not a problem. So I have to do a little bit of forward thinking, but generally it's not really a day-to-day challenge until something comes up where I have to think a bit different. So maybe a fire alarm or something we're not expecting.
So in that kind of situation, what would be your approach? Is everyone quite nice? Do they help out?
And that very example, the fire alarm and the fire evacuation, I have to have two buddies that effectively are responsible for helping me to get out of the building. And we often joke that if there was a fireball behind them, then the quickest thing would be to push me down the stairs, worry about the broken bones later, and make sure they get out of the building. When you're young and you start to realise that you are different to perhaps the friends that you're around with, and so you're a little bit more restricted. So even though my parents were very, very supportive in what I did and used to, take me around to where I needed to go, my friends would obviously, meet up with each other and perhaps catch the bus to go places, or, do things that I just wasn't capable of doing. I wasn't able to walk long distances or do things without that extra sort of level of consideration. So I think that has challenges as well on a sort of a social level as well. And certainly at school, outside of, various bouts of bullying I received, I think it was difficult to integrate to the level I'd like to, I think.
Does anything like that ever affect like relationships or progressing your life in that kind of area?
I think it is difficult for people to understand how my disability might affect them in a relationship. So I think that, attempts to have relationships have either not worked out or not started. And I don't know whether that's ever been a factor, but of course, in my mind, you think, I wonder if it was a factor, and how am I absolutely sure that it wasn't? It's a difficult consideration to have, and something that I've got to be careful not to put too much thought into, because I shouldn't convince myself it's because I've got a disability that the relationships didn't sort of work out or wasn't able to have more relationships to this point. But I can't ignore the fact that it could be a factor. So most likely it has been, but as for a permanent thing, I don't know. People don't necessarily understand difference, and some people, find dealing with that more difficult than others. And so you can't help but think at times that perhaps it's something that you're doing versus, their problem. I think as I've got older, and especially in my adulthood, you realise that actually people sometimes can't cope with difference. And I think I was a target for them as they sort of tried to deal with that, which was extremely unfortunate and very upsetting at times and very difficult. But that part of my life is thankfully behind me. And if there's any other issues with that in my later life, then obviously I can handle that in much of a different way than perhaps I was able to before. There was a very embarrassing moment where I slipped on the steps up to the court at Winchester one day. So the defendant was in the dock, my colleagues were, behind me, and I was carrying my books up the steps, and obviously the court had risen. They were standing, waiting for the magistrates to come in. I walked through the door and fell on the first step. So while I was okay, the difficulty is people don't know how to react. And of course, you know, with the defendant in the dock as well, it was a very interesting time. But, you know, very quickly I get up, I brush myself off as I usually do, as long as I'm not injured, and, you know, touch wood, I've never been injured from a fall.
Now, you're quite a big fan of cricket, so, and other sports as well that you really get into. How did you sort of get into that? I know it must be hard not being able to join in PE or not being able to get down to the local club or something.
And that's exactly how it happened, actually. My PE teacher at the time, a gentleman called Roger Fittle, pulled me to one side and said, "Steve, you know, I find it difficult to think of things to write in your school report. Obviously, PE lessons aren't the same experience for you as perhaps others. And I've come up with an idea, and I'd like to teach you how to score, as in score a game of cricket," which I thought was great. He said, "But first of all, I do want to give you the experience of playing cricket." So I remember facing, I think, 37 balls when I was batting. Not able to connect with the ball at all. I wasn't able to make the movements quick enough in order to connect with the bat and play the shots that perhaps was required, which again, you know, in my later life, with my cricket experience, I can now sort of, you know, join the dots together. So if I think that was in 1993, that means, you know, I've been scoring for a very long time. And I think that was the beginning of lots of things that I've done since. And so I always say to people whoever ask that, you know, that guy, Roger, my PE teacher, was probably one of the most influential people in my life, without him even realising the level of impact he was about to have.
How would your parents feel about this? Obviously, from birth, having a child that they may not necessarily have been prepared for,
sure.
It was like, offers different challenges for parents.
I think they, as parents, probably have the same concerns that any parent would in terms of, you know, how will Steve find his place in life? What will he do with it? You know, what sort of job will he have, and what sort of success can he make of life? I think they had additional fears along those lines when, you know, my paediatrician, when I was born, said, "Mr. and Mrs. Vear, I think you need to prepare yourself that Steve will need to go to a special school. He, you know, won't be able to lead the same life as other people, not necessarily being able to take jobs like other people, and we'll really struggle with life." Because I'm very aware, if I'm being very honest with myself, that, you know, my dad is a huge sports fan, he's a huge football fan, you know, and he'll never see his son run around a cricket field and score a winning goal or play sport that he can enjoy, you know, which perhaps he would have wanted to do, you know, before I was here. And I know they're very proud, because actually they do tell me that. And my dad made a point of saying that actually at my sister's wedding last year, which was quite emotional, bringing when I was about to give the best man speech. So that was rather difficult to sort of stay on message and not lose composure, but we got there. But so that was very pleasing and very touching to hear my dad actually, you know, put into words how he felt, because I hadn't really heard him say that in quite the same way before. So that was pretty special. I mean, there was an incident back in 2010 where Basingstoke was hit by a snowstorm, and I was travelling on the way home early because the snow was falling, and because of the traffic and the accidents that happened, we actually got stuck for 8.5 hours. So it took me 8.5 hours to travel 20 odd miles. And while I was okay at the time, or thought I was okay, you know, what followed in the next few weeks was a very difficult period where I started having nightmares, flashbacks, waking up in the middle of the night, not wanting to go to sleep or even go to work in the morning for fear of repeating what happened, not really know what was going on. And so about a week after this happened, and I shot up in bed one night, 4 o'clock in the morning, and, you know, really panicked and thought, this isn't right and I need to sort of solve this. And through some work with some support I got through work, it turns out that I was suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, which even now when I say it sounds a little bit odd, but when I spoke to the expert on the helpline at the time, they said, you know, the words I used was, how can I have PTSD if I've not been to a war zone, not lost a leg, all that sort of stuff? And she sort of said, well, you know, for you, that was, you know, still a trauma. You couldn't get out of the car like other people to desert the car to get on the train to go home. You had to stay where you were. And
so if it did happen that there was a miracle that for one day that you weren't disabled, what would you do?
As odd as it sounds, I think I might like the feeling of knowing what it's like to run up and down a staircase without holding onto a banister or worrying about whether I'm going to fall down it or lose my footing. But I think I'd have to hope that if it ever was to happen, that miracle, that it'd be on a nice hot summer's day and I was around my cricketing friends and perhaps we could either enter into a cricket net or go out on the field and see whether or not you know, I
pretty good cricketer or pretty awful at it. I think it would be a good test, bearing in mind all of the things that I've done to do with the sport. So I think it would have to have a cricketing theme, as well as doing perhaps some things like the staircase, or maybe just go for a run and just see what it's like. So, it's a difficult question because it's not something that I necessarily have ever wished for, funnily enough.